Good morning. We welcome all of you who have joined us today. We are in week number 11 of our summer sermon series entitled Empowered by the Spirit. In this series, we are looking at the period of time between the resurrection of Jesus and the day of Pentecost. And our focus has been on Acts chapter 1, where Jesus prepared his disciples for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Our text today is found in Acts chapter 1, verse 15. Acts chapter 1, verse 15. I would like to begin, though, with a scripture that's actually found in the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 14, verse 21, that says, "But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had never been born." Warren Wiersbe once said, "If you are not born again, the day will come when you wish that you had never been born at all." This morning, we turn our attention to a man who is one of the most reviled men in all of history. He is a person that we curtly dismiss from our attention because we just really don't want to deal with him at all. But he is in the Bible, and we cannot just skip over his story simply because we don't like the repercussions and what it means for you and I today. And so, in order to stay true to the Word of God, we must take a look at a man by the name of Judas Iscariot and learn from his examples. Perhaps the place to begin is at the end of the story. It is now early Friday morning in Jerusalem, sometime between midnight and dawn, and the Jews are finished with Jesus. They have had their kangaroo court with their trumped-up charges and their false witnesses. Annas the high priest has had a round with Jesus, and so has Caiaphas, and their verdict is clear. This man is a blasphemer who is worthy of death. And the assemblage of religious leaders set out to take Jesus before Pilate, the Roman governor. He is the only one who can legally order Jesus to be put to death. There is movement, there's noise, there's clatter as the group moves down the rocky hillside towards the praetorium inside the ancient walled city. And in the shadows, one man, now forgotten, watches, his face strained and his eyes puffy, his head slightly bowed. It's been a long night, the longest night of his life. How many hours have passed since that meal in the upper room? 6, maybe 7 hours, who knows? After he left, he had went straight to the chief priest to make final arrangements. And then there was a short walk in the darkness across the Kidron Valley and up the wooded slope of the Mount of Olives. And the whole thing really had not taken any more than about 5 minutes. Just a blur, a few words, a kiss, and some angry comments by Peter and the others, and then Jesus was arrested and taken away. And in his hands, Judas held that little bag that contained 30 pieces of silver. He hadn't even bothered to count it. No one even paid him any attention now. It was like he was yesterday's news. No one had any use for a traitor. And through the long night, he waited. He was hanging around the edges of the crowd, listening for some word of how things were going. What exactly did he expect? No one knows for sure. But if at midnight he wanted to see Jesus die, by sunrise he had changed his mind. Memories flooded his mind. Things that Jesus had said. Little jokes the apostles used to tell. Stories Jesus had told them over and over again. Little pictures painted themselves in the darkness. The smile on the face of Jairus' daughter when Jesus raised her from the dead. The look on Peter's face when he walked on the water and it actually held him up. And the picture of those 12 baskets of food that were left over after Jesus had fed a multitude of people. And Judas could see it all and he could hear it all. And the memories were just almost too much to bear. Then the rumor spread that Jesus had been condemned to die. He shouldn't have been surprised, but Judas was. For a moment, there was a commotion in the courtyard, and Judas saw Jesus as he was being led away to Pilate. He didn't see him clearly, just a glimpse of his face from a distance, but he knew it was him. Overwhelmed. That's really the only word that we could use. Judas was overwhelmed with the thought that Jesus was going to die. In that moment, it came to him. In a blinding flash, he had made a great mistake. The greatest mistake of his life. So great a mistake that he must somehow figure out a way to make things right. And with that thought filling his mind, he took that little bag of money and he tried to give it back, but the chief priests just laughed at him. They had no more use for him or for his money. They had what they wanted. And in desperation, Judas cried out in Matthew 27:4, he says, "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood." Every word was true. He had done it, and what he had done was the worst sin imaginable. He had betrayed the Lord Jesus, who, though he was innocent, was about to pay with his blood for Judas's crime. With that, Judas threw the money back into the temple, the coins clinking and ringing as they hit the stone pavement. And as Judas turned to go, the 30 pieces of silver stayed behind. Judas not only lost his Lord, but he also lost his money. Very shortly, he would lose his life. About his suicide, very little needs to be said. The Bible just simply says that he went out and hung himself. It is the final act of a man who could not live with himself and the memory of what he had done. And the ultimate irony on this tragic day, Judas ended up dying before Jesus did. But it was not always that way. If we go to the beginning, we find a remarkable series of facts about Judas. We learned that he was personally chosen to be an apostle by Jesus Christ. We learned that he forsook all to follow Jesus. Judas spent 3.5 years traveling the length and the breadth of Israel alongside Jesus and those other apostles. Judas saw all the miracles of Jesus in person. Judas heard Jesus give all of his famous discourses. Judas watched as Christ healed the sick, as he raised the dead, as he cast out demons. Judas, along with the other disciples, was sent out to preach the gospel. Judas was one of the leaders of the apostolic band. No one ever suspected Judas of treason. In terms of experience, whatever you can say about any of the disciples, you can also say about Judas. Everywhere they went, he went. He was right there, always by the side of Jesus. He heard it all. He saw it all. He experienced it all. However you explain his defection, you cannot say that he was less experienced than any of the other disciples. If anything, he was one of their leaders. After all, it was the other apostles who chose him to handle the money. You don't pick a man whose loyalty you suspect to handle your money. That's crazy. You pick your best man. You pick the most trustworthy man. You pick the one man that you can count on. That's why they picked Judas. The most interesting part of this story is that the other apostles apparently saw only the positive side of Judas. It wasn't until they looked back afterwards that they could see the negatives. Before his betrayal of Jesus, Judas looked as good as any of the rest. And in fact, in some ways, he probably looked better than most. In that light, let us take note of it for the record one more time. No one suspected Judas. No one. There are two things that perplex us about Judas. First of all, why did he do what he did? And secondly, after he had done it, why did he feel so guilty? He was so evil that he sold the Lord for 30 pieces of silver, and yet afterwards he felt such remorse that he ended up committing suicide. Couple of questions. Here's the first question. Why did Judas betray Jesus? Why did Judas do it? What forces conspired to make him betray his Lord? You know, over the centuries, great minds have pondered that question. If you want an interesting Bible study, pick up a Bible dictionary and read about Judas. You will discover a bewildering array of theories. You know, the gospel writers offer us very few clues. It is likely that they never knew the answer either. And since Judas committed suicide within a few hours after his betrayal, we really have no statement giving his side of the story. Therefore, we are left to only speculate about his motivations. Let me just offer up three possible theories as to why Judas may have did what he did. Here's the first theory. He betrayed Jesus for money. Now, this makes sense in the fact that John chapter 12, verse 6 tells us that Judas actually stole money from the money bag. In other words, he extorted money out of the apostles' bank account. But if he betrayed Jesus only for money, he sold him far too cheaply. I mean, 30 pieces of silver, it would only have been something like $20 today. A second theory we could offer up would be he betrayed Jesus because he was disillusioned. Now, this is probably the most prevailing theory. It suggests that Judas had expected Jesus to lead an uprising against the Romans. And when he found out that Jesus had no such intentions, he became angry and he felt betrayed by him. A third theory that is possible, he betrayed Jesus because he was frightened. You know, as Judas watched the storm clouds gathering in the final few days, he betrayed the Lord in order to save his own skin. All of those theories make sense, and all three of them might contribute to the answer. After the discussion is over, we still don't know why Judas did exactly what he did. But this much is sure. When Judas betrayed Jesus, he made the biggest mistake that any man has ever made. That brings me to a second question. Why did he feel such remorse? Well, the answer is that Judas was like most of us on the inside. torn by opposite impulses. He should have been better, or he should have been worse. If he had been a better man, he would never have betrayed the Lord. If he had been worse, he wouldn't have felt so miserable about it. And he died a tragic death, miserable and guilt-ridden, with the blood of the Son of God on his hands. So where is Jesus or Judas today? Is he in heaven or is he in hell? Well, the Bible, believe it or not, is sort of clear on that. It says that Judas is in hell. Acts chapter 1, verse 25 says, Peter spoke of Judas, who left his apostolic ministry. He said to go where he belongs. Literally, the verse means go to his own place, which is also how the regular King James Version and the New King James Versions render this. Go unto his own place. His own place refers to hell. Now, if that seems kind of harsh to you, consider the words of Jesus in John chapter 6, where he says in verse 70, Jesus answered them, did I not choose you, the 12, and one of you is a devil? He spoke of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for it was he who would betray him, being one of the 12. Now, he did not literally mean that Judas was a demon, but that Judas was even then, about a year prior to the crucifixion, Judas was acting under Satan's influence. Listen to the words of Jesus as he prays in the upper room on Thursday night. Judas has left to go make the final arrangements. Even now, the soldiers are gathering for the march to the Mount of Olives. And the final act is about to play itself out. Meanwhile, Jesus is in the upper room and he's praying for his disciples. In John 17:12, Jesus says, while I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, except, see that word, except the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Now, I'm not sure we can find anything plainer than this. He has been in hell, Judas has, for over 2,000 years, and he'll be there forever. He has paid the ultimate price for the crime of betraying the Son of God. Let me just offer up three more questions for us to consider. Here's the first one. You might ask, did Judas lose his salvation? You know, there would be a group of folks, you know, the once in grace, always in grace bunch, who would say, no, he didn't lose his salvation because he never had it in the first place. Well, that's like saying, well, if my car breaks down, then it must not have really been a car to begin with. Now, I don't want to get into an argument over semantics in this message. And I might add, in some cases, that might be true. It may be true that certain individuals don't lose their salvation because they were never saved to begin with. However, in many cases, folks who were genuinely saved, and some even sanctified, have gone back on the Lord and have forfeited their salvation. If you go back to the parable of the sower, Jesus described four types of soil that the seed fell upon. And if you read the story carefully, you will discover that the seed actually produced plants in three of those four soil types. Now, just because the plants die out in the stony ground or the thorny ground, does that make them any less of a plant? No, they were plants. I will agree, they weren't healthy plants. They were plants facing obstacles. But whatever else you can say about them, they were still plants. At no point can you say, well, they weren't really plants to begin with. Here's the thing. None of us are qualified to judge whether or not a person is the real deal. Now, I know the scripture says that by their fruits you will know them. But the problem is that you can't see the fruit because Jesus says you got a big beam growing out of your own eye. See, you are not a mind reader. And you don't know what is going on in another person's life. None of us are qualified to be a good judge of character. I don't care how much confidence you have that you can read other people. You can't even read yourself, let alone read somebody else. And I've discovered that people can keep hidden pretty well things in their lives if they want to. I have no way of knowing if Judas was genuine in the beginning or not, so I cannot answer whether or not he lost his salvation. A second question that pops up, someone may ask, did Judas go to hell because he committed suicide? That's a good question, but I'd have to answer no. We can debate the issue of suicide, and Christian people come down on both sides of the issue, but suicide is not why Judas went to hell. Judas went to hell because he rejected Jesus Christ. His betrayal proved that fact. His suicide merely sealed his fate. That brings me to a third question. Doesn't the Bible say that Judas repented? Well, the older translations indeed do use that word in Matthew 27:3. A more accurate rendering would be he was seized with remorse. Although Judas was gripped with the wrongness of what he has done, we never actually read where he specifically asked to be forgiven. There's a world of difference between experiencing remorse and asking forgiveness. You know, many people who truly feel sorry for their sins never actually come to God and ask forgiveness. Judas tried to undo his betrayal, but it was too late. I do not doubt that he wept bitter tears as he threw the money back into the temple. But his remorse, as sincere as it was not true repentance, and it did not lead to forgiveness. Instead, it led to suicide, the ultimate proof that Judas died an unforgiven man. You know, as we think about the strange, sad story of Judas, several questions rise to the surface. These are questions not about Judas, but they're questions about you and I. See, these questions ask you and I to examine ourselves of how much Judas lives inside us today. And before we think about these questions, consider this. The more religious that we are, the more likely we are to do what Jesus did, or what Judas did. You know, if Judas were alive today, the best place to find him would be in church on Sunday morning. He would come in early, he would sit near the front, he would sing the hymns with gusto, he would clap during the choruses, he would shout amen during the sermons. See, Judas was just that kind of a guy. If there is any way to understand Judas, it is at the point of personal disappointment. Perhaps he truly believed that Jesus had let him down, and in his own twisted way, felt justified in his act of treachery. But is that so much different from the way that you and I feel when we feel that God has let us down? So I ask the question, how has God disappointed you? See, for some, it comes as shattered dreams and fond hopes that are never realized. For others, it may come from a failed marriage, or from children who have turned against us. Perhaps you have prayed and prayed and prayed over a loved one to be healed of cancer, only to attend their funeral at a later date. Maybe you feel deep down inside that God simply just hasn't lived up to his end of the bargain. And though you would never say it out loud in church, you feel cheated by the Lord. Let us face the fact that God often fails to live up to our expectations. Sometimes he simply doesn't do what we think he ought to be doing. We have certain standards for the God of the universe, and he doesn't always meet them. And Judas couldn't live with the disappointment, and so he betrayed the Lord. How about us? See, one of the ironic parts of this story is that Judas didn't get a whole lot for his money. In those days, 30 pieces of silver was the price of a slave, about $20. Judas went to hell, and the cost of the ticket was 30 pieces of silver. What would you trade for Jesus? Would you betray him for money? Would you betray him for a better job? Would you betray him to keep the job you have? Would you betray him to save your own skin? Would you betray him to get a better grade in school? Would you betray him to get a date with a certain man or a certain woman? Would you betray him for a new contract? Would you betray him for $1 million? Would you betray him to find a husband or a wife? Would you betray him because he didn't live up to your expectations? Would you betray him because you thought he let you down? Would you betray Jesus if you thought you could win the favor of important people? See, the story of Judas asks us to probe at the level of our own personal motivation. Why do you serve the Lord anyway? How much is the Son of God worth to you? You know, many years ago, I heard an evangelist preach a sermon with an interesting title. And the title was, A Second Judas. A Second Judas. And it was aimed at church folks who had not completely sold out to Jesus. And as I recall, he told the story of Judas, and then he talked about himself, how he had grown up in the church and how he had attended Sunday school for years. He had gone to a Christian college, and if my memory serves me correctly, he had even become a pastor before he realized that he had never truly been born again. He himself had been a second Judas. And it was humbling and it was painful for him to face the fact of his own self-deception. But when he did, he was wonderfully converted by the Spirit of God. You know, that can happen to any of us. Judas kissed the door of heaven, but ended up in hell. Jesus picked him as an apostle, but he went to hell. He lived with Jesus for 3 years, and he still went to hell. Judas watched Jesus walk on the water, and he still went to hell. Judas listened to the Sermon on the Mount, and he still went to hell. Judas ate with Jesus, talked with Jesus, walked with Jesus, and listened to Jesus day after day, month after month, year after year. He knew Jesus as well as one has ever known Jesus. And he still went to hell. And remember this, none of the disciples suspected him. That's why he was chosen to be the treasurer. They trusted him to keep their money. Even at the Last Supper, when Jesus identified Judas publicly, they still didn't figure it out. Do you know who is most likely to be Judas in the church? I am. You know, as a pastor, I stand in the closest analogy to the place where Judas stood. Someone may say, well, surely not you, Pastor. But remember, that's what they said about Judas. Remember, the shock of Judas's betrayal was that he looked so good on the outside. You know, if I can tell you this story without searching my own heart, then I have missed the point. I want you to know that I truly believe in the assurance of salvation through the Word of God, through the testimony of the Holy Spirit. I am not in favor of constant introspection, you know, wondering about whether or not you're a Christian. But there is a place for healthy self-examination in the Christian life. No one should take for granted their hope of heaven. And I wish to say as clearly as I have considered the matter this week, the thought occurs to me that if I am a Christian at all, it's not because I am a pastor, an elder, a church member, a husband, a father, or a doer of good deeds. None of those things matter in the least when it comes to my salvation. If I am a Christian at all, it is because I have trusted in Jesus Christ and Him alone for forgiveness of sins. I'm staking my hope of heaven on the fact that Jesus died for me and He rose from the dead. If Jesus cannot take me to heaven, I'm not going to make it. My trust is not in the preacher. It's not in the church. It's not in grandma's salvation or grandpa's salvation, or not in the fact that I pay my tithes or I go to a certain church. My trust is not in the good works that I do. My trust is in Jesus alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. You know, Judas does us a favor in this story, because it causes us to rethink our basic commitment to Jesus. If you call yourself a Christian, are you a true follower, or are you just going through the motions? Are you a pretender, or are you a true believer? Have you truly turned from your sins and trusted Christ as your Savior? Are you a fair-weathered friend of our Savior? You know, these are searching questions that may be easier to ask than to answer. I ask you not to take them lightly. The one main lesson from the life of Judas is lost unless we at least ask ourselves these questions. After all, if one can be an apostle of Jesus and still be lost, what's that say about you and I? Perhaps we can conclude the matter this way. One apostle was lost, that none should presume. 11 were saved, that none should despair. In the end, most of us who call ourselves believers will search our hearts and conclude that yes, although we fail Him in many ways, we do love Jesus and claim Him as our Savior. You know, the story of Judas in the Bible, it's there for many reasons. Not the least of which is that before we take anything for granted, we at least ask the questions that the other apostles asked on that fateful evening. They turned to Jesus and they asked the question, "Is it I? Is it I?" Let that be a question that you ask yourself today. Lord, is it I? Let's pray together. Thank you for joining us. Lord, we just love you so much. Father, we search our hearts. We wonder about ourselves. Lord, as we think of the story of Judas, help us to examine ourselves and help us to ask ourselves some really tough questions. Lord, so many times we read about Judas and we just shake our heads and we think, I could never do that. And yet the truth is, Lord, there are some of us who betray you quite often. Lord, we pray that we would turn from that. Because, Lord, it gets too easy to be distracted by the world. We pray, Lord, that our focus would be solely upon you. And Lord, in those times of life where we get disappointed, Father, help us just to trust you. Help us to place our salvation on you. Father, we just pray for your help. Show us the things you want us to see in our lives. We thank you and praise you. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. We're glad that you could join us today. We hope that you'll be with us next week for part 12 of our series, Empowered by the Spirit. Lord willing, we'll continue to look at how the Holy Spirit prepared the disciples for the coming of the day of Pentecost, and we're going to continue to focus on Acts chapter 1 leading up to the events just before the empowering of the church. Don't forget, Lord willing, we'll be back this Wednesday night at 6:30 for our live online Bible study on the life of the Apostle Paul. This week, we're going to be looking at part 16 of this study, looking at the topic of neck deep in Greece. We'll be looking at Acts chapter 17. This Bible study series is only found online. It's the only place that you're able to view it, so I hope that you can join us. If you miss any of the Bible studies or sermons, you can check them out on Facebook or check them out on YouTube. Go to our YouTube channel and you can watch them there. Just type in Lebanon First Church of God into the search bar on YouTube, and you should be able to find our channel. If you have a Google account, a Gmail account, you can actually log into YouTube using your Google account, and you can subscribe to our channel. So check that out. Thanks again for joining us today. May God bless you as you seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. You are loved. We'll see you later.